So I guess first and foremost, it's now more than 24 hours, right? 36 hours, soon it'll be 48 hours. How does it feel now, a day later, a day plus later, knowing that this happened in your city?
Well, it feels like my city has just experienced a tremendous trauma, which it has. This was a terrible and an unacceptable event. And you know, I really emphasize the word unacceptable because we shouldn't tolerate in, not just in our city, but in our state and our country, the proliferation of these weapons that can indiscriminately fire at large numbers of people and injure and kill dozens. We have a real sickness in this country and in this culture. And I know it's not all about guns, but I think that must be the primary focus. I put it this way. Why can't we have a sane conversation in this country and have a line? And on one side of the line, we say that we respect private gun ownership for self-defense, for hunting, and for sport. And on the other side of the line, we will do everything we can to eliminate assault weapons, ghost guns, guns that have only one purpose, and that is to maim and injure dozens of people at a time. We don't make that distinction in this country. Now, in California, we have a number of very aggressive laws, the best in the nation. But what does it take for somebody to go to Nevada, to go to another state, go to a gun show without any background check requirement and come back? What does it take for someone to go on the internet and to be able to purchase the component parts of a ghost gun? There's more we can do, including Governor Newsom's idea around if those who are opposed to abortion can sue abortion providers, as the Supreme Court says they can, which I disagree with, by the way, strongly. Well, why can't we turn that on its head and allow people to sue the manufacturers of these weapons of mass destruction? This is not just a city issue. I mean, it happened here. We are experiencing the trauma. We all have to look inside and see what we can do better, but this is a national issue. And until we come to grips with curing this sickness around the glorification of violence and the proliferation of multi-fire weapons, this is gonna unfortunately and tragically continue to happen.
Now, today we learned the names of the six people who were killed. And I think it goes from a number like we had yesterday to names. And six people, either from the area, visiting the area, are now gone. What's your message to their families today?
Well, this is senseless. And my message to the families is that we will do anything and everything we can to envelop you with our support. I mean, we have set up, working with the district attorney's office, working with the governor's office, support centers at Cal Expo and elsewhere, where we are going to do everything we can for the families, as we should, as we must, because they're the ones suffering the most. And tonight at our vigil at 7:30, we have to hold them close, even if they're not there. Mm-hmm. But it's not enough to just give our thoughts and prayers and support and then move on. That's what happens too often. That's what happens when these sorts of mass shootings occur throughout the country. Thoughts and prayers are not enough. What is the action we are going to take? In our city, we are already investing significant resources, unprecedented level of resources in young people and in gang intervention. Now, these were adults that were killed and we don't know who the perpetrators were, but it all starts upstream. We got thousands, tens of thousands of guns off the street last year. And we can never prove what tragedies were averted as a result of those efforts. But we need to double or triple those efforts and put the resources behind getting more of these guns off the street. And so it is a time to support the victims and their families and anybody who witnessed this, but it's also our opportunity to continue to take stock of what we can all do better, to do everything in our power to try to avert the next tragedy.
Mm-hmm. That being said, I do think we've heard yesterday during one of the press conferences, you encouraged people to continue on, to not let this get in the way of everyday life, to continue to come to downtown.
Yes.
This was less than 24 hours. The bodies of the victims were still at the scene. Do you think that that was a little bit too soon to send that message?
Well, I was asked the question, and so I responded. And I was referring to the days and the weeks and the months ahead. And I think it is very important, obviously, that we put the victims first, but we also recognize that there are a lot of hardworking men and women who have opened businesses, small businesses downtown. There are a lot of people who work downtown. And I think it is important for the mayor to speak to the wide audiences here and to all of the issues that we are feeling in the moment. And so, no, I don't think it was too soon because it wasn't isolated. I answered the question, do I think people should go downtown? And my answer is yes. Mm-hmm. There are two responses to tragedy, which, by the way, can occur anywhere. Could have occurred anywhere, and it occurred at 2 o'clock in the morning. We can cower, and we can say that we are going to isolate ourselves from one another, or we can recognize that this downtown is a growing and beautiful place with a lot of challenges. I mean, look at this weekend. Or this week, we had three major concerts. You had Wicked. You've got restaurants that have long waiting lists, reservations for people to get in. People need, especially during this period of time, mm-hmm. people need to be among each other. People need to be out. I mean, we've had enough with COVID and people being isolated. So it is not in any way inconsistent with our first responsibility, and that is to care for the people who are suffering, the victims, and to continue to elevate the precautions that we're already taking, additional security, additional lighting, additional security cameras to assure and reassure people that downtown is safe, and to say, live your lives because we need to be with each other.
Now, in that same, I guess, kind of question, yesterday as the crime scene was still being processed, you know, almost 24 hours later, we had a Kings game, we had things going on in the city, we had folks walking down the sidewalk on the same street as the families that are still mourning these victims whose bodies are still on the street. Do you think that the city should have taken the approach to cancel all major events, or do you think that it was the right thing to do to continue on with the Sunday night activities?
First, a couple of things. I want to really thank our first responders, by the way, our police and our fire departments. I mean, the heroic work that they did in the most difficult of circumstances, including trying to save lives of victims. I just want to make sure that I say it. But the answer to your question, do I think the city should have canceled all of the events? No, I don't. No, I don't. Because I think we are capable of mourning the victims. I think we are capable of supporting their families. And at the same time, making sure that that people can be connected with one another in positive ways. And that's really what downtown and a civic center is all about. People need to be connected. And people need to be connected. And so, no, I think we are capable, more than capable, of both giving the right space and the priority to the victims, and at the same time encouraging people to be with one another.
Some people might be, frankly, scared to go downtown at this point.
I understand.
What's your message to them? What is the city doing? Saturday night's going to come pretty soon here, and people are going to be thinking possibly twice about going out downtown. What's your message to them, and what's the city going to do?
We have recently, over the last several months, invested over $8 million in what we call Clean and Safe Sacramento. That's the money that's being invested in additional security cameras, in lighting on JK and L Streets, additional lighting, on additional security, and a separate pot of money to do the same things in Old Sacramento. And so we are enhancing security. I would urge people to take precautions, to be aware of your circumstances. That's the prudent thing to do. And I would say, and it's just my opinion, get home early. I don't know that people need to be out, you know, late hours. Maybe that's just my age speaking. But, you know, get home at a decent hour. But come down, be aware of your circumstances. We're taking extra precautions. Have a good time and live your life.
Now, one of the other things that we have kind of heard from people, you know, is this going to be San Francisco, LA, where we've seen these recent, you know, an uptick in crime in these major cities? Should people be worried about that happening in this city?
Well, crime is up all over the country. You know, it was two plus years ago, right before COVID, where the city went two years without a single youth homicide. Now, again, this was not a youth homicide, but those numbers are changing, and there is an uptick in crime and in violent crime. It's not unique to Sacramento. And yes, people should be concerned. We're all concerned. The question is, what do we do about it? Well, I'm against any notion of defunding the police. I think the police play a very, very important role in protecting our community, but they can't do it alone. It has to be a real partnership with those who provide the youth services, with the community-based ambassadors who know what's really going on, who can intervene if there's a fight to make sure that it does not escalate into something more violent. And so it's all about a partnership. The city must invest in its public safety resources, including its police and fire. But public safety also includes investing in young people, investing in our community, building up the hope in these communities, and not just downtown, but all of our neighborhoods of Sacramento. Again, I like to think that in my 5 years, we have begun to change the arc of what we consider to be a core priority of our city. The city used to be just a service provider, and that's still our most important function. But now we're directly investing in communities, directly investing in youth and violence prevention and gang intervention and economic development and attracting new industry and the creative economy and affordable housing. And so that's the modern role of a city and our city. And it's the combination of all those strategies that will help Sacramento get through this. I'm not a Pollyanna about any of it. I know what's happening. I know that people are afraid, but I also see unprecedented amount of construction and building in our downtown, people moving downtown. I see all the new restaurants and the food scene, the new theater, the convention center, the Golden One Center, top-notch concerts and sporting events. And so we just have to be smart. We need to lead. We need to enhance all that we have started to do to provide people the assurance that they're going to be safe, and recognizing that there are never guarantees in life, that sometimes these terrible things happen, and it's our job to do everything we can to prevent it from ever happening again, without guaranteeing that in any city in California, in the United States, especially with back to the proliferation of these awful weapons, that these kinds of things will happen, and we need help. We need help from the federal government. We're getting a lot of help from the state government. I think the president has been very vocal on gun violence, as has the governor. But we have to choose to live, to move forward, and to do everything we can to keep people safe, but also to promote a great quality of life in our city.
Now, we know one person has been arrested in connection with this shooting. When you heard that news, what was your reaction? Relief?
Well, no, because the investigation is not done. I will say this, I have every confidence in our police chief, Kathy Lester, and our police department that they will arrest the people responsible for this and that they will be brought to justice. They are working 24 hours a day. I mean, I don't know how they do it. And that's a key part of this too, is to in ensuring the public, is that the people who perpetrated this crime get arrested and be brought to justice, and that will happen.
Now, in your opinion, do you think this was violence that escalated, obviously? Was it random? Was it premeditated? Is there any?
I just don't know, and I don't want to prejudge it. I've seen the video, which Channel 3 has run a number of times, and obviously there was a fight, and then there was rapid fire gunshots. But I don't know, and I will leave it to the police to complete their investigation, thorough investigation, and then we will know all the facts, and maybe we will learn some lessons. I mean, again, it's just me, but I don't know why everybody needs to be out and about at 2 a.m.
Yeah. I have just one last question. We ended our newscast last night with just the unity that we've seen so far, the care and the kindness and the support that people in the community have already shared. And Sacramento Strong has been something that we've been seeing a lot of. What makes Sacramento strong, and what's your message to the city today?
Well, this is a terrible crisis, but it's not our first crisis. You think about what we've been through over the last couple of years, and I remember back when I was a new public official, Sacramento was hit by a number of hate crimes from white supremacists. And here's the thing about Sacramento, we always step up. This is an inclusive community, it is an engaged community, it is a community that cares for one another. When one suffers, the others who weren't the direct victims stand up. And then when it happens to the next group, the people who were victimized stand up for them. That's the beauty of this community, and it never, ever changes. And so together, we are going to envelop the victims and their families. That's number one, and hold them up. And as a community, we're going to do what Sacramento has always done. We're going to take our pain, we're going to take our trauma, we're going to learn lessons, and then we're going to continue to be and to continue to become a great city.
All right. Mayor, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for having me.